Hi everyone, I'm Jackie. I'm hoping this is working. Hi everyone, I'm Jackie. I'm from Youth Advance Australia. I just thought before I dive into it all that I'd just give you a little bit of information about me. Looks like a few people are struggling to join. Let's see. Anyway, so a little bit of background about me. I am currently the Client Awards Centre Manager at Youth Advance Australia, and I'm approaching working here for about a year, which is super exciting. History about me and the Duke of Ed Award. I completed all three levels of my award, bronze, silver and gold, in high school. And I've got to say the absolute highlight of my bronze level was probably, not bronze, my gold level, was summiting Mount Kosciuszko for sunrise. Was a 4 a.m. start, so quite early, but it was the most beautiful experience I've ever had. So that's super exciting, and that's something that you guys can, you know, work towards, all your own personal goals, which is even better. Hopefully we've got a few people on here now, so I'll dive into what this information session is going to cover. But obviously, you know, with the ongoing concerns and challenges around COVID-19 affecting many people, and obviously their progress with the award and some of the activities they might be undertaking, we'd like to stress that yes, 110% you can continue with your award, and that there's, you know, just a few modifications or new activities we might have to do. But that's what we're here for. We're here to help you through that and guide you through some processes and things that you can think about. And so that's what we're here for today. I'd also like to just remind you to like our Facebook page and follow us on Instagram, and to do the same with the Duke of Edinburgh Award Australia, the National Award Office, just to, you know, keep up to date with, you know, what's going to unfold in the next couple of weeks. And we'd also like to thank everyone for your patience and understanding throughout the past couple of weeks, just as we've tried to readjust our processes and practices to try and make it all as efficient as possible throughout the foreseeable future. So quickly, what I'm going to try and cover in this live stream is award modifications that you can make, some particular points that I'd like to stress to you, and some other additional things you might want to take note of, as well as some modifications and alternate activity suggestions for all your sections of the award, and then I'll just give a quick summary of it as well. I'd just like to mention as well that we're going to no longer be doing a question time at the end of this, but rather any questions that you comment, we will try and reply to them throughout this feed, or we will try and get back to you about them in the coming days. So don't stress, we will try and answer them if they're not already answered in this video, but if you don't hear from us in a few days, then feel free to contact us. So firstly, some general award modifications that you might want to consider is that consider discussing your activities and what you're doing with your assessor and maybe any modifications that they might have in mind, or any minor activities that you might be able to undertake, and any suggestions that they may have that you can do with your award. So consider maybe, you know, talking to them and seeing, you know, what activities and parts of your activity that you may be able to undertake at home. And so that's something that your assessor can come up with some ideas about, or you. But either way, it should be something that you discuss with them and come to a mutual agreement upon. And with that in mind, just think about, you know, for the next couple of weeks, but also potentially the next couple of months as well, and what you can do. We also are trying to encourage our assessors and your assessors to try and be flexible and understanding at this time, you know, just to help you get along and make a move with your award. For those of you that have major and minor sections as part of your award, so that will be every bronze participant and anyone that's been a direct entrant into silver or gold, keep in mind that you can always change your major section. So you could consider, if you're struggling with your service activity, consider maybe moving it to your skill or your physical recreation as your major, because that on those ones you may not be struggling to get the hours for. So consider that you can always change it, and that might help you obtain your hours that you need without having too much impact. Additionally with that, with your major section, that adds an extra 3 to 6 months onto your award already. So you don't actually have to start your minor sections until, you know, that extra amount of time is up, so 3 to 6 months. So, you know, for example, with your bronze award, your major section is an extra 6 months. So you have 3 months there before you actually need to start either of your minor sections. So don't stress too much if you haven't got them sorted yet. As long as you've got your major sorted and you've started that one, that's what you should really be working towards. As well, just a few more general options that you consider is, you know, modifying your goal slightly so that a few minor tasks that they're still relevant to your overall activity that you're doing for that section, you know, that might be able to fit into it. So whether that be you're doing netball as your activity, but it's been postponed now, maybe doing some general fitness at home and adjusting your goal so you can fit in some general fitness might be an option. However, if you're making some adjustments that are on a larger scale, a bit more significant, then maybe we should consider setting up a whole new other activity for that section. And keep in mind when doing that, that it does need to be set up as a brand new activity. So same goes for when you're setting up your other ones, that you need an assessor commencement guide and you need SMART goals. So just a few things to keep in mind there. If you do choose to start a new activity for one of your sections, just for your information, you can always go back to your other section, your other activity that you're already doing. So if you're trying to do netball and that's not going to work, so you're going to change to running, which you can do individually, but then netball starts again, you want to count that again, then you can always go back to netball. So that's something to keep in mind. Something that I already mentioned, but I would like to stress to you, is that if you are only making any modifications or undertaking any smaller tasks for any of your activities, you need to check with your assessor that they are still okay to be your assessor for those smaller activities. So if you're going to do home workouts or something for netball or soccer or whatever sport it may be, I'm sorry, sports my go-to for examples, but if you're going to do that, you need to check with your assessor that they'll be okay to still assess you for those slightly smaller tasks and what you may need to provide them for them to feel comfortable and okay with doing that. And again, this should be something that's discussed between the two of you and mutually agreed upon. And again, in this time right now, because you're not seeing your assessor as regularly as you usually would, we really want to stress that you should try and contact them on a 2 to 4 weekly basis, just to keep in touch, discuss your progress, you know, anything that you might want to change, anything you want to work on, and how they can help you with achieving your goal that you set for your activity. So just keep that in mind. The last really important thing to note is the detail in your activity logs. So your activity logs, especially now, need to contain a lot of detail. I mean, they should in general, hopefully, but that's definitely something you need to focus on at the moment. So something that you can include to help, you know, make it a bit more detailed is things such as evidence, which I can expand upon in a little bit, but also maybe the mode of the activity as well. So whether you were doing it online or you were, you know, following a book that you had for workouts, something like that, or if you went outside and did a run or you did something face-to-face following social distancing protocols. So something like that, you know, just discussing how you went about it, as well as, you know, mentioning what you actually undertook. So if you're doing reading, for example, mention what book you're actually reading, how many pages you read. And then talk about maybe, you know, what you excelled at, what went well this time. And then think about maybe what you struggled with, what you want to improve upon for next time, and what you would change or modify for next time as well. So just think about some other different aspects of your activity that you could talk about within your description to help someone like me or your assessor who's not seeing you actually understand what you undertook and what you would like to improve upon and those kinds of things. With evidence, a great way to provide this is simply just videos and photos and screenshots, you know? So get someone like a sister, a brother, a mum or dad to just take a photo of you undertaking your activity, whatever it may be, and then just upload that when you're doing your log. And then it's also great evidence to send through to your assessor as well when you meet up with them once a month, just to, you know, provide some evidence that you've actually been doing what you said you were going to do. So that's something really important to think about. Some other great resources as well that you can use for evidence is, let's say you were using an online video or something for your activity, then maybe include the link to that video if it was on YouTube, or the link to the website or the book or something that you might be doing. So just mention where you're getting it from. So that's another great way to include some evidence into your logs. Some additional information and resources to note for your award is that all minor modifications should be discussed and made with your assessor prior to starting these smaller tasks that you're going to do, if you choose to. If you're unsure of whether these smaller tasks and proposed adjustments that you want to make are suitable or not, then contact us. That is what we are here for. We're here to help you through this difficult time and help guide you and give you some assistance with how you can, you know, make your award continue. Again, if you are starting an additional activity, set it up as per usual like your other ones with an ACG and SMART goals, but you don't need to worry about completing an award plan. And keep in mind with these activities, I know it may be hard to find an assessor for some of them, but you know, consider teachers at school are still a really great option. You can just send them an email, you know, once a month with some evidence and be like, "Dear Mrs. or Mr., whoever it is, this is what I've done over the past month. I'd love to get your feedback on some other things that I can improve on, or some other resources," or something like that. So we would really, you know, stress that you try and find teachers maybe. If you're really struggling, let us know. We can help you come up with some other ideas of who you can use as an assessor. But remember, it cannot be a family member. And I know that's going to be quite hard in the coming weeks potentially, but that's what we're here for again. So just give us a call or an email and we'll try and come up with some creative solution for you. In regards to adventurous journeys, at this stage, all of our school-based programs have been pushed back and we're currently working with the schools to find alternative dates pending how this whole situation unfolds. We're hoping these dates will fall into term two. However, if necessary, they may need to occur at a later date, but we will keep you posted as we get more information about that. In regard to our open AJs, if you have booked onto one of these April school holiday programs that are going out, potentially, you will be contacted directly in the coming days in regard to your program. If you were looking at booking onto one of these programs and haven't got around to it, or you're just not quite sure, because you won't be on that direct mail out, send us an email and let us know and we will provide you with the necessary information. Now, some additional resources that you might want to keep in mind. So hopefully you've got some sort of notepad and pen or Word document or something ready. But the award handbook is a great resource. In there, it's got so many ideas for activities for your skill, your service, and your physical recreation. Like, and when I say lots of activities, I mean like 3 pages long. Like there's so much in there. So definitely go give that a look if you're struggling, and I don't suggest any that seem appealing to you. But keep in mind when looking through that some of those activities aren't suitable for the current circumstances. So just keep that in mind and think about what, you know, what's appropriate, what's not. Another one is the Duke of Edinburgh Award International Award Australia branch. They have put together an awesome document that's called Delivering the Award During COVID-19. So in that, they've outlined beautifully a few different ways that you can go about continuing your award in each of your sections. So that would be a great document to have a look at. Don't stress, we will be providing links to lots of these resources, all the ones that I'm going to mention plus more in an email tomorrow. So just take note of the name, but you'll have links to all of these tomorrow. Another one is the Duke of Ed Australia page actually has a useful links page, which has got a bunch of websites for different service ideas that you can look at. So some of them I've got here, some of them I don't, but that's another great page to have a look at. One of our Open Award Centre participants actually sent us an email today already having found some alternate activities using this different website, which I didn't actually know existed, but it looks awesome. So basically it's from the Duke of Ed UK and it's called Duke of Ed Participant Opportunity Finder. So even if you just Google that, it'll probably come up as the first result. But basically you can just pop that in and you can scroll through and there's a bunch of different opportunities that you can have a look at. And most of them are Duke of Ed approved. The only thing you need to keep in mind is that these activities are based in the UK. So some of them are online and you can do online for free, but some of them, if they're online, you know, sometimes we get restricted access to them because we're in Australia. So just keep in mind that you need to be able to have access to them for the duration of whatever activity it may be. So just keep that in mind that it's a UK site, not Australian. So there might be some difficulties there, but who knows? I encourage you to give it a go and have a look and see if you can find anything on that. Some other great opportunities I guess search engines for volunteering opportunities. One's called Do Something Near You. That's another great one. And that's, again, you just kind of pop in what you're thinking about. There's a little like criteria bubble. I can't think of the word right now, but it's called youth. And if you click on that one, it kind of filters all the results to activities that are appropriate to people that are between the ages of maybe 14 to 20. And plus, so activities for that age group, but also some that, you know, work with youth people as well. So that's another great way to filter those results and have a look at those. Another one is Seek Volunteer. Again, a great search engine for volunteering opportunities. I would have a look at that, and you can filter that to online and remote volunteering as well, which is a great way to see if there's any online opportunities that might be available. Another one is New South Wales Volunteering, but it's NSW, not New South Wales. So that's another great search engine as well as Go Volunteer, another similar sort of thing. UN Virtual Volunteering is another great one. There, some of the activities might be better for slightly older participants, and some might be better for slightly younger. So again, that's one you have to go on and you kind of have to filter the options yourself and see whether they're age appropriate or not. And that goes for the ones I've said before as well. Another great one that I found earlier today is called Reach Out. You might be familiar with that organisation, and they do have volunteering opportunities from people aged. It's about 15 or 16, I think, some of them, but it depends a little bit. But again, they've got some great volunteering opportunities as well. All right, I will now go into a few more specific modifications and ideas you can make for your physical skill and service sections. All right, let's have a look. So for your skill, some modification ideas or small tasks that you could maybe undertake include things such as maybe taking an online class or course. So we found one of our participants already found an online at-home first aid course that you can undertake. And that would be something great to do for your skill or for your service, something like that. Or they've also found an activity where you can, I can't remember exactly what it was, but I think it was learn about endangered species, which is another great thing, and they're going to actually use that one for their skill. So that's something, an online course that they could undertake. Other ones, you can do a language courses as well. That's really common. So have a look, but that's a great idea to think about how you could take it at home and work towards your activity and your goal. Other ones that you can consider are maybe YouTube skill development courses or tutorials for new skills. So for examples that if people are doing cooking for their skill or drawing, I'm sure that there's some videos online on YouTube where you can learn new skills. So for example, to cutting techniques for cooking, or cooking techniques like con carne, a tomato, that's something. Or there's a julienne style cut, so of vegetables. So there's things on there that you can use to help enrich your skills for those activities. Another one you can consider is maybe skill development apps available on electronic devices, whether it be phones, laptops, tablets, whatever you've got, such as Duolingo is a great example of something like that, which obviously that's an app for learning new languages. There's lots of other similar ones like that out there. So again, I would encourage you to have a look and just, you know, see what's out there, what's available and what's suitable for you. Some alternate activity ideas for skills. I've already touched on some of these, but drawing is a great one that you can do from home, and that's something that you can learn online as well. And then simply a good way to just, you know, show to your assessor that you've improved is send through a bunch of drawings that you've done and, you know, mentions different skills and all that stuff that you've been trying to learn as well. Some other great ones are photography. That's one you can do at home and with less social contact. So that's a great one to consider. Cooking I already talked about, playing an instrument is another great one to do at home. And again, you can learn new skills from that online, so that's another great one to consider. I found this one really interesting I came across in the award handbook, but typing, like computer typing. I'm sure there's some online programs that you can use to help improve computer typing, so that's a great one to consider. Creative writing is another one you can do, and an English teacher would be a perfect assessor for that. They could set you weekly tasks that you could do, different skills, things like that, that you can, you know, help work towards a new goal or something. Some other ones are singing and reading. They can also be done from home. And again, there's a lot of resources out there available to help you complete them at home. So that's just some activity ideas that you can think about for skill if you're struggling with your current one. But again, there's lots more options in the award handbook. I will always reference that. So that's a great resource to have a look if you're a bit stuck. And if you've got any questions about that, again, you can contact us. Yeah. All right. Some physical recreation modifications. Some ones that I thought might be quite useful are home workouts. So something like muscular strengthening exercises, or cardiovascular endurance workouts, so that's kind of just like general fitness, whether you can run a long distance or not, and stretching and flexibility is another great option as well. So these may be available through like online courses and classes, as well as YouTube videos and apps again. So similar to the skill, there's a lot of online resources for these workouts, and these would be really great for honestly any sport. Like if you're doing netball, you need cardiovascular endurance. If you're doing rock climbing, you need muscular strength. So for almost any activity that you're doing, you'll be able to find some sort of resource on there that you can use to help continue your award at home. Another option that you could consider is some physical activity skill development, which is basically just practicing skills relevant to your sport or physical activity that you've chosen at home. So some examples I came up with this was, you know, passing a soccer ball or a netball with a sibling, if you've got one, or mum or dad or whoever, throwing at a wall and catching a ball, you know, which, or a tennis ball or a handball or something, you know, for catching development. So that's something that's relevant to, you know, cricket, baseball, softball, t-ball, anything kind of like that. And the same goes, you know, with netball and basketball. You can throw the ball to the wall, and that, you know, helps with your catching technique as well. Another thing you can think about is maybe shooting practice, you know, for netball and basketball. But again, it's just general skills that are relevant to your sport and activity that you're doing, that you can somehow make a game or an activity out of it at home. So that's another great way to think about completing your hours. Some alternate activity ideas for your physical if you are struggling. Running and walking are two great ones. You can do them by yourself. We're still allowed to go outside and exercise, so it's a great way to get out of the house, get some fresh air, and keep your fitness up. So those are two options that are super good. And again, you can get a PE teacher at school to help sign that off. Yoga is another great one for general strength, flexibility, and stretching. I love yoga. It's a great one to do, and literally applicable to almost any sport or activity that's in physical recreation. So a great one to consider, and there's lots of online apps I know there's a YouTube channel called Yoga with Adrienne, I think it is, and that's a great YouTube channel, and she's got so many great yoga videos. So definitely, if you're considering that, have a look there. Some other ones could be swimming. You know, I don't know if there's any pools that are still open, but open water swimming is still a great option as well if you're comfortable with that. As well as some dancing at home, that's another great option as well. Whether that be, you know, you're doing online classes with your teacher, or you're practicing your dances for mid-year concert or whatever it may be, or for school, as long as it's taking place in your own time outside of normal school hours, if you're still in school, or university if you're in uni, as long as it's being undertaken the majority in your own time, it's allowed to be counted towards your GQVET. And cycling is another great option as well for all those cyclists out there. All right, now the one that probably most of you are struggling with, your voluntary service. So I've got quite a few pages here, so we'll see how we go. But some modification ideas that you can think about for your voluntary service activity. One I would consider, but again, all of these need to be discussed with your assessor or the relevant organisation that you were or are still trying to undertake your activity with, just to make sure that they're okay with it and it's something that you can do. But one would be online research. So for example, bush regeneration, you know, researching what weeds are commonly found in the area and learn, you know, what they look like, effective ways to get rid of them. Again, you know, environmental conservation, looking at animals in the area, their breeding habits, what they eat, what their predators are, you know, things like that. Just researching about the activity that you're undertaking. If you're working at an organisation that helps the homeless, you know, researching some statistics about, you know, the homeless population within your area, what you can do to help, how other people can get involved, you know, things like that. Another one is maybe assisting with online communication for the organisation that you're involved with. So whether that be maybe creating some social media content for them, so researching relevant activities or events or organisations or inspiring stories that they can post about, or finding some images that they can use for those posts. So that's a great option as well. Another thing that you can consider, if they'll allow it, is maybe helping them with maintaining their website. And again, you know, creating social media content can work towards, you know, blog posts or posts on their website or content for things like that. So that's another good option as well. But I think the one that might be most relevant to most people's voluntary service options and activities is making it an online or virtual activity. So there are so many people that have had to move their jobs or whatever to a more virtual and online format, such as me now. So a great option, it's a great option for, you know, tutoring, mentoring, coaching, whatever it may be. So if it was tutoring, for example, you're assisting people with reading or schoolwork, whatever it may be, consider, you know, if it can be done via phone or email or Skype or Zoom is a popular format at the moment, you know, so see if there's some way that you can take it online. But an important thing to consider when doing that is to check with all the people involved if they're okay with that to happen. So whether that, obviously you would be okay with it if you're suggesting it, check that your assessor is okay with it, and the individual being tutored, and that person, parents and guardians, and also check with your parents if it's okay. Another one it's great for is coaching. So you can consider maybe using a sibling or a parent to demonstrate some exercises and activities or drills or whatever it may be that you would like the team that you're coaching to work on at home, and then distributing that however you wish. But again, that's another great thing. You just have to talk to the people involved again to see if that's something that they would be on board with and something that you could do. Some alternate activity ideas for the service section. A great one at the moment would be finding someone to assist you, or you might be able to do it yourself, but however you wish, to complete some of the tasks I'll mention next. For people that are slightly older, so aged, immunocompromised, disabled, or people that are even self-isolating as well. It could be, you know, walking their dog or mowing their lawns or general basic gardening, doing their grocery in general shops, or even calling and talking to them. The only catch with these kinds of activities is that you can't do it for just one person or one family. It has to be for multiple people. Multiple people have to benefit from it. So what I've got written here is these tasks will need to be undertaken for multiple groups of people, not just one individual. So multiple families that are self-isolating or multiple aged or immunocompromised or disabled individuals. So not just one person, but multiple people or multiple families. If you are going to undertake these tasks, I would suggest or recommend that you do have a trusted adult or guardian accompany you for the duration of these tasks. It's just a safety thing that needs to happen. And again, if you are doing these activities, you should exercise personal hygiene and safety precautions in line with the rules stated by the government. So just keeping up to date on the current information that we're getting and just abiding by that. Some other options that might be a little bit easier, you know, less hygiene things to worry about and things that can be completed from home. Great thing is knitting. So there are lots of organisations that allow you to help knit things for their organisation, which they then can distribute to other people that need them or animals, in the case of knitting pouches for bushfire affected animals. So I do know that Wires will accept these pouches, and they've got little templates on their website that you can use to help knit these pouches. So that's a great option. I would definitely consider that. Another option is this company called Wrap for Love. So what they do is they create blankets that are knitted by you, and they give these blankets to people experiencing extreme poverty, effects of war or natural disasters. So simply all you do is you buy some wool that meets their standards that are outlined on their website, but it's not too much, it's pretty simple. And you've got to have a pair of knitting needles, and you've got to have probably a YouTube video or something that you can use to learn how to knit if you haven't before. It's super fun, you feel really good doing it. It's for a great cause, but basically all you do is you just knit a square. It's not very big, I can't remember the exact dimensions, and you knit multiple squares, obviously not just one if you're doing it for your service, that's minimum of 3 months. And these squares, they get knitted together to form the blankets, which they then give to these people. So that's a great option, and again, it's for a great cause, so something that I would recommend doing. A few other slightly alternative options. You can assist with research into the population changes, survival rates, and breeding timing of Antarctic penguins. I already have one participant that's interested in doing this. Basically, it's with this company or organisation called Penguin Watch. And basically, what you do is you're counting and tagging penguins in Antarctica by viewing aerial videos and photos of these penguins. And so obviously with these information, statistics and data that you're providing, the researchers can use that to then develop their statistics on how the population changes and, you know, breeding and survival of these penguins. So it's a really great cause, again, very different, but very interesting. So that's something that you can consider. And a science teacher at school would be a great, great option as an assessor for this activity. I just realized I didn't give a suggestion for the knitting activity, but when I was at school for the knitting activities, my librarians actually signed me off on that. So if your librarian knows how to knit, she could be a great option as an assessor for that activity. Another option is this activity called DigiVol. It's DigiVol. It was originated from the Australian Museum needing some help to basically make all their displays and resources and everything that was in their museum online. So they needed help with transcribing the notes and the information into a digital format. So that's what it's originated from. It's now expanded into many other people that use this format. And basically it's you help transcribe handwritten diaries, scientist notebooks, and specimen labels, as well as identify location data to turn it into a digital format. So by doing this, you're helping museums and universities open up their research material to everyone online. The data has many uses, but most important is that it can help scientists and planners better understand, utilize, manage, and conserve our precious biodiversity. So as I said, this was originated from the Australian Museum. On another note, the Australian Museum has a variety of volunteering opportunities. So I would recommend going to their website, clicking the Get Involved, and have a look at what options they have there that you might be able to partake in. Another one that I mentioned earlier is the UN Virtual Volunteering. So again, that's another one that you can have a look at. Some of the activities there vary from translating and teaching to some things that were a bit more full on, I guess. So have a look at that. There might be something there that takes your interest. Explore the option. So have a look at that. Some of the additional volunteering opportunities I did talk about earlier, but again, it's just the Duke of Ed Australia Useful Links page, Duke of Ed UK Opportunity Finder, Do Something Near You, Seek Volunteer, NSW Volunteering, Go Volunteer, UN Virtual Volunteering, and Reach Out. If it looks like there may be some age restrictions for these activities that they're showing, consider contacting the organisation directly to see if you could engage in the activity with an adult or guardian present. And again, I would say for any of these activities where you're going out and engaging with the community, I would suggest seeing if you need a parent or guardian present with you if your assessor is not going to be there. Well, not if you need it, I would have that. I would have a parent come with you if your assessor is not. So that's just something to consider. So that's kind of all I have for the volunteering opportunities. If anyone has any more questions about that, let me know. Give us some time to send out a summary of this and to go have a look at the resources we'll send you. And then if you're still a bit stuck, then just let us know. I think most people might struggle, if anything, with finding an assessor. Again, I would like to stress that teachers at school are a great option. I do understand that they have a lot on now. We do appreciate that. But basically, all that's involved with them is maybe 5 minutes to complete the assessor commencement guide. Then they check in with you once a month, and that can simply be a 5-minute phone call where you just discuss what you've done and what you're planning on doing for the next little while. And then at the end of it, all they need to do is take 5 minutes to write a small little report, basically just verifying that you did what you said you did and that you did make some progress. So all in all, it really only takes 15, 20 minutes of their time. So I think if you explain it like that, they might be happy to do it. We have a lot of teachers that are super, super happy and excited to help out our Dukes. So I would definitely ask them. And if you've got any, if you're struggling for an assessor, if you really are struggling to find some options, then let us know and we'll see if we can do anything to help you out. So that's kind of everything I wanted to touch on. I know it's a lot of information, but I do thank you for sticking with me through it all. And just so you know, this information will be broken down in the coming weeks, and it will be addressed through school-based meetings for our client award centres, as well as some additional live streams and meetings for some other participants, such as our open award participants. Additionally, we are planning on making this live stream a regular activity occurring every week on a Thursday at 4:30 p.m. Sometimes it will be presented by me, Jackie. Other times it may be presented by my colleagues, maybe Jack, Marcus, Charlotte, or if we're super lucky, Keith might even do it for us. So keep an ear out for more information, and we'll try and get these started as soon as possible. Please make note that tomorrow a summative email will get sent out with the general contents that I covered today, as well as a slightly more extensive list of what activity modifications and ideas I covered today, as well as all the resource links that I said we'll give you. They will be in that email as well. Next week, we're planning on doing lots of school meetings for our school-based clients. So keep an eye out, because in that email, we'll try and have, well, not try, we will have our school meeting timetable in there with hopefully some links to the Zoom meetings. So if you haven't already familiarized yourself with Zoom, I would recommend giving that a go. It's pretty simple, straightforward. But yeah, have a look at that so you're ready to go for next week when we get to the meetings. And then we just want to mention that, you know, if you're experiencing any financial hardship right now, there is award funding available. So if this is something that you might benefit from or you're interested in, just give us a call or send us an email, and we'll point you in the right direction and help you out with that. And lastly, I would like to encourage people to brainstorm together with either your school peers or whoever it is that you know that's doing the award, with what you can do, any creative activities that you can come up with. And I really would like to encourage you to share these ideas with each other, as well as us, because we're still trying to develop our list of how we can help you and what resources we can give you. So let us know if you've come up with anything interesting. We already know a few participants have come up with some great ideas and have taken it. They've been very proactive about this situation in finding some new things to do. So let us know so we can showcase you and your activities and your ideas. And yeah, so hopefully that's everything. And I've answered all your questions. If you have anything more, I would wait until next week or after you've received our email tomorrow and given us time to respond to your questions. If you still have anything more after that, or we haven't properly addressed what you wanted us to, just send us an email or give us a call, and we'd be more than happy to help you out. So that's me. Enjoy the rest of your week and weekend, and we will be in touch soon. Thanks.